I call this meeting of the Williamsburg James City County School Board to order. First item on the agenda, or second item on the agenda, is 2.02 Pledge of Allegiance. Mrs. Cordasco?
Yes, I want to invite the students from James River, Carolyn, Isabella, Madeline, Carla, and Sydney to come and lead us in the pledge. Would you mind doing that?
Somebody step up to the microphone.
Yep. You can all stand there together if you want. There's the microphone right there.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, ladies. The reason why they're here on their giving up their summer vacation will be evident here shortly. 2.03, the roll. Ms. Serza?
Ms. Cook?
Here.
Mrs. Cordasco?
Here.
Ms. Emanuel?
Here.
Mr. Kelly?
Here.
Ms. Larson?
Here.
Mr. Nichols?
Here.
Thank you. 3.01, certification of closed session. Can I have a motion?
Mr. Chair, I certify that to the best of each member's knowledge, the Williamsburg James City County School Board, while in closed session, discussed only public business matters lawfully exempted from the open meeting requirements as stated in Virginia law, and that only such public matters as were identified in the motion convening the closed meeting were heard, discussed, or considered.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? Ms. Serza?
Mrs. Cordasco?
Abstain.
Ms. Emanuel?
Aye.
Ms. Larson?
Aye.
Mr. Nichols?
Aye.
Ms. Cook?
Aye.
Mr. Kelly?
Aye. 4.01, approval of the agenda. Have a motion for approval of the agenda?
Mr. Chairman, I move we approve the agenda as printed.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? Moved and seconded to approve of the agenda as presented. Ms. Serza?
Ms. Larson?
Aye.
Mr. Nichols?
Aye.
Ms. Cook?
Aye.
Mrs. Cordasco?
Aye.
Ms. Emanuel?
Aye.
Mr. Kelly?
Aye. That brings us to 5.01, announcements. Superintendent's report, Dr. Constantino.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, members of the board. One announcement this evening for students and families. School starts September 8th. Just wanted to remind everybody of that. I'm sure all the parents have that day circled on their calendar. We are busy readying our schools for the first day. Teachers will report next week, and open houses are scheduled on the following days and times. High school open houses will be from 4 to 6 p.m. on September 1st, middle schools from 4 to 6 p.m. on September 2nd, and elementary schools from 4 to 6 p.m. on September 3rd. We're preparing and looking forward to another great school year. And that's the only announcement I have this evening, Mr. Chair.
Okay, board recognitions.
Thank you. We have several individuals we'd like to recognize this evening. We begin by recognizing five students from James River Elementary School. Would Caroline Bauer please join us up front? Caroline was named the International Baccalaureate Mid-Atlantic Regional Student Excellence winner for her international mindset and service to the community. We'd also like to recognize four additional James River students for their commitment to the IB philosophy. Students, as your name is called, please come up front to be recognized by the board and remain for a group photo. Isabella Gilbert, Madeline Hanlon, Carla Rojas, Sydney Walker. I'd also like to invite Principal Michael Stutt, an IB representative, Carrie Lancaster, and the retired IB coordinator, Janet Parker, up front as well. And congratulations to these fine young ladies. Don't move, because there's a lot of moms and dads photos going on out there.
Yes.
We get it? There we go.
Congratulations again.
For the 20th year running, the Association of School Business Officials International has awarded the Williamsburg-James City County Schools Finance Department its Certificate of Excellence in Financial Reporting for the fiscal year ended June 30th, 2014. This is the highest form of recognition in the area of governmental accounting and financial reporting. The Government Finance Association of the United States and Canada also recognized the Finance Department for their comprehensive annual financial report. On behalf of the department, I would like to ask Christina Berta and Renee Ewing to come up front to be recognized for these outstanding accomplishments. Mr. Chair, members of the board, I'd like to also point out that Renee Ewing has been on part of our finance department for 16 of those 20 years of resignation. You knew I couldn't get through the whole thing. Recognition. Splice the tape. Recognition. Congratulations to the finance department for these exceptional accomplishments. We'd also like to continue with another department recognition. The Public Relations and Engagement Department has earned national recognition for their great work in video production. The National School Public Relations Association awarded our PR department awards of merit for distinguished achievement in the category of the school district video produced in-house for Snow Days Never Bothered Me. And the Path to Achievement videos. I'd like to ask Betsy Overkamp-Smith and Ronnie Showa to join us up front to be recognized.
Shouldn't you get a...
No, I don't want to see. No, you really don't. Operations guy took the picture. Mr. Chair, that's all the recognitions we have for this evening. Thank you.
Do any board members have any recognitions this evening? I have two. One, I'd like to thank the kindergarten teachers who came in for the Jumpstart program to help some of our kindergartners get accustomed to school before school starts. I think that's great. Dr. Constantino, is there a birthday tomorrow?
No, not that I know of.
No? Okay. Happy birthday, Dr. Constantino.
Happy birthday to you.
A day early, so. Brings us to 7.01, citizens' comments. We have one speaker card tonight. Mr. Nichols?
Is at this point in our meeting where citizens are invited to address the school board. Those citizens desiring to speak have submitted speaker cards to the clerk prior to the start of tonight's meeting. When a speaker's name is called, the speaker comes to the podium and states his or her name for the record and directs his or her comments to the chair of the board. In order to promote a listening and respectful environment, please avoid applauding, verbal outbursts, in any other type of demonstration when the speaker is addressing the school board. Personnel matters are not considered in public meetings. The school board requests that all speakers refrain from making any reference to specific individuals in any form or fashion. The school board's role is to listen to the speaker rather than to respond to his or her comments. Each speaker is allotted 3 minutes to make his or her comments. The school board asks each speaker to respect this time limitation. Time may not be yielded to another speaker. Your acceptance and adherence to these guidelines will be greatly appreciated.
Thank you, Mr. Nichols. Mrs. Cordasco?
I have one card, Deborah Debout. Did I say that wrong? I'm sorry. Is it Tia Van Debout?
Bebout.
Bebout, I'm sorry.
Oh. Mr. Kelly, my name is Deborah Bebout. I live in the James City County neighborhood of Powhatan Woods. I respectfully ask the school board to pursue restoration of limited opportunities to compete in the event of diving, on behalf of interested swim and dive team members at the three local high schools. This request is grounded in the VHSL mission to engage Virginia's youth in a variety of activities and competitions that promote education, personal growth, sportsmanship, leadership, and citizenship. I am making a specific request to expand the permitted scope of activities for existing swim and dive team coaches to include all the VHSL required events in their sport. The three WJCC high schools all have swim and dive teams whose members have been precluded from all participation in the diving event at all high school levels for the past several years. However, the VHSL sport of swim and dive is regulated by the NFHS Swim and Dive Rulebook, which requires all head and assistant swim and dive coaches and officials to be familiar with each and every required event, which means any of the head or assistant coaches can attend VHSL-sanctioned invitational meets and the state championship meet to address WJCC liability for the event of diving. I respect that the county has chosen to direct financial resources within each of the sports programs offered in a manner that provides personal growth opportunities for the greatest number of athletes. Participation in the event of diving can be restored within the existing financial structure exclusively at the invitational and state competition levels, preserving fairness at the regional and district level, where there are currently no divers, while enhancing fairness at the state championship level, where VHSL ruled in spring 2014 diving would remain an event included in final team scores, whether or not individual teams were able to provide a qualified competitor for the men's and women's diving events. Significantly changing the scope of allowed activities for existing coaches to include attendance of VHSL-sanctioned invitational dive meets has no financial impact. However, the impact on individual student athletes could be substantial. County athletes are currently unable to qualify for the diving events held annually at the state championship swim and dive meet. Our youth are being denied personal growth opportunities within the existing financial and staffing structures of WJCC supported swim and dive programs, as well as the possibilities of becoming a Virginia High School state champion, earning the distinction of All-American status, or working towards a college athletic scholarship in diving. Please consider the current prohibition on coach and athlete involvement in the event of diving within WJCC supported high school swim and dive teams. Please help enhance fairness at the swim and dive state championship level and expand personal growth opportunities.
Thank you for your comments. I appreciate it.
Thank you.
Are there any more comments? Any more speakers?
No.
That brings us to consent agenda 8.01, approval of minutes from the following meetings, June 2nd, June 16th, and July 21st, 2015. Financial report, monthly bills and payroll, July 2015. Personnel actions and release from compulsory attendance, case number R16-02. Do I have a motion?
Mr. Chairman, I move the consent agenda.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Any discussion? Moved and seconded for approval of the consent agenda as presented. Mrs. Sturza?
Mr. Nichols?
Aye.
Ms. Cook?
Aye.
Mrs. Cardasco?
Aye.
Ms. Emanuel?
Aye.
Ms. Larson?
Aye.
Mr. Kelly?
Aye. 9.01, new middle school conceptual design process update. Dr. Constantino?
Thank you. Mr. Chair, members of the board, this evening is the first of several updates to the board for your information on the progress that we're making toward the design and eventual construction of the middle school at Blair. Let me just make a few remarks before introducing Mr. Hall, who will take you through some more specific information. But just for the sake of continuity, when we first started having conversations a few years ago about the middle school, we understood a couple of important things. One, that whatever decision was made, we were going to live with for the life of a building, which is about between 35 and 50 years. I think secondly, we understood through educational research, building design research, and understanding what's happening around us in terms of buildings that promote learning, and in our own strategic plan, we understand that our ability to personalize learning, our ability to provide flexibility in learning so that students can be redirected and supported and moved on when ready. I think that we are not interested, never have been interested, in the warehousing of students. And all of that, we have talked about it. We've had some presentations both with the school board and in some joint meetings. We understand the importance of emphasizing collaboration among students. When we listen to workforce development partners, we hear consistently the need for students to work together, to problem solve, to think, all of those things. Those are messages that we get pretty continually when we meet with the business organizations and we meet with the workforce development folks. We also want to offer opportunities for students in science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. I think it's very difficult today to look anywhere in which STEM or STEAM programs are not being offered to students in middle schools, certainly in high schools, middle schools, and now elementary schools. We understand the importance of the need for applied mathematics, the need for applied sciences when it comes to preparing a workforce. And lastly, we need to create spaces that can be used now and 20 years from now, so that should there be a need for reconfiguration or a need for change, those changes would be a bit more simple than having to either remodel or reconstruct. We've given you a lot of information over the last few years, and tonight really represents the first conceptual conversation we're prepared to have with you. Before Michael talks, I just want to let you know that what you'll see tonight are not the floor plans of the building. I want to make that clear. These are conceptual designs based on our input to our architects and educational planners. And also, as you know, I visited a school that was designed similarly, got a chance to talk to the former and present superintendent, principal of the building, several teachers in the building, and have a pretty good understanding of the education that is possible when we design a space that can be used for numerous purposes. So with that introduction, Michael Hall is here. As you know, Waller, Todd, and Sadler are the architects that were selected and approved by the school board. Michael is here to give you just a brief glimpse at where we are so far, to perhaps share a little bit more information about the educational concepts, a little bit about the design concept, and then a review of the critical points in the timeline that will come forward. And certainly we'll take any questions that you might have. Mr. Hall.
As Dr. Constantino said, we are partnered with Waller Todd Sadler. We're educational facility planners. We work all over the country in partnership with various firms around the country. And our role in the process is to bring concepts into the discussion. It's not our role to dictate. It's not our role to drive a design in a certain direction. It's our role to work with your design team, your curriculum people, your educators, to give you the building that fits your community. So you're going to see some concepts here tonight that we've been working with the design team. We're still moving towards a final design. We have another meeting a week from Thursday, a three-hour meeting to work through a lot. It's being done very interactively with a computer and moving things around in front of everybody until we get what fits your district, not what we're recommending or domineering the discussion, but listening and trying to respond. We're here as resources to your folks to give you the right building. So with that, the concepts that are driving the design, number one, first is a school environment in today's world that is secure and safe, student-centered, and then features flexible and seamless technology, not technology as an afterthought, but technology that is brought into the design, knowing that in 3 years it's all going to change anyway. A design approach that emphasizes collaborative, project-based, interdisciplinary instruction, and a facility that supports that. That we offer opportunities to kids in STEM and STEAM throughout the curricular design that we end up with. and that we incorporate both indoor and outdoor spaces to enhance learning and environmental awareness. Our goal is that learning starts the minute somebody steps onto the site, whether it's an adult or a child. There are interior and exterior features that contribute to the learning environment. So it's a holistic approach to not just a building, but to a campus. And so that's our role in working with your team. We use a lot of flexible furnishings. As you'll see this photograph here, these are called node chairs. And we are the society that's taken us 6, 10, 15,000 years to figure out we should put wheels on our luggage. And so it's important now in today's learning environment that things can move, kids can move, furniture can move. And I'm going to show you a video in a little bit that illustrates that. But we are supporting not the kids that you and I were. We're supporting digital natives. My four-year-old grandson has a tablet. And, you know, Papa, where's your tablet? Well, I have a cell phone and a laptop. I don't have a tablet. Papa, everybody needs a tablet. And he's showing me his tablet. So it's a different world that we're educating kids for. We need to allow connectivity, not just within the building, but globally, because we're a globally connected world now, and kids are aware of that. And they can, with the appropriate technology and the right furniture and stuff, and the flexibility within a room, they can get in small groups, large groups, however they want to do it. And it not only helps them learn, but it fosters a social interaction amongst children, and it generates collaboration. And I think if you look at the way the workforce is today, collaboration is the basis for all big steps forward. We're all collaborative in nature, and everything, as an architect, we collaborate with engineers, with educators, with contractors. It's a collaborative environment. It's not somebody sitting in their office dreaming what needs to happen, but collaborating with stakeholders and others to give you the right facility. Next slide. This is what we call a neighborhood, and this is a neighborhood for 150 kids. You'll see six yellow, beige, what look like classrooms, but those are operable walls and or glass walls that separate them. So you can have two classrooms, three classrooms together, or you can open out onto what we call the maker space or the collaboration area. And there's a shared science lab. There's restrooms within there and lockers. So it's a self-contained environment. And this is the design approach that the design committee has kind of settled on to make this really a premier middle school, the best middle school that's out there. So this is the environment. When you build it, it actually starts to look a little bit like this. And you'll see the glass walls, nano walls is what they're called by the manufacturing name. You see kids in small groups. You see transparency in the building, not just for teachers and students, but also for safety and security, that people can see through the building and see what's going on. And the neighborhoods can then, if they need to go into lockdown, they're in a small, self-contained group of 150 kids. So we think that's important in today's environment, safety and security, not just technologically, but within the design of the building. And then the bottom right corner is that every space in the building should be a learning opportunity. So some of these, what we would call commons areas or corridor space, becomes places where kids can go and meet in small groups, and that's observable by adults from any point in the building. So that's one concept, is this transparent and flexible learning space that we're looking at. Next slide. This is what we call the dancing chairs. This is a building that Steve was in this building with me and Howard Collins from Fowler Todd 2 weeks ago, and it's being used this way now, and it was envisioned this way. But if you can click it, this is what happens in a building that has these type of characteristics in it. And this is change that can happen in a learning environment, not over the Christmas holidays, but this can happen between 8 and 9 o'clock in the morning. It can happen multiple times in a day, as the teaching staff come up, have different ways to present information, from small group to large group to more traditional classroom group, even to a large gathering, in this case 100 kids, to see a video presentation or to see a speaker. And that's the reason for the mobile furniture. And so that's a part of the discussion as we move through the design process with your team. Next slide. And this is that space that we were in 2 weeks ago out in Arizona, being used as it was designed, kids moving around. You'll notice every child in there has a device in their hands, whether it's a laptop or a phone. And the teacher there on the right side is not what we would call the sage on the stage lecturing, but the teacher is a facilitator. And the teacher moves within the groups at times, sometimes brings it together in a traditional setting, but it's flexible. And it can change as needs change. It can change as education changes. So these are the concepts that we're sharing with your staff in terms of collaboration in multi-purpose labs. It's not just the science lab maybe that you and I think about. It's a multi-use lab. There is some traditional science equipment, but there's also a collaboration space that shares that. These are called next generation labs. That's the term that's out there now. And you'll find that in the literature around the country. So as we look at multi-use labs and as curriculum changes over time, we need to be able to adapt to that. And it's very, very hard to adapt a traditional science lab design to any flexibility for the future. So this is called the Next Gen Labs, and we're looking at those with your folks. And then seamless integrated technology. Whether it's a digital whiteboard, or whether it's devices in every child's hand, or whether it's what we call the upper right corner, huddle spaces, where three or four kids can get together and huddle and connect into the technology. And there's a lot of learning that goes on one-on-one in these huddle groups, which is a lot different than you or me sitting in a chair being lectured at for 50 minutes or whatever class period used to be. So this type of environment is what we are looking at with your group. And you know, there's been some educational part from people my age within the group that said, gee, this isn't what I'm used to seeing. And yet when you go back to where we started, we're doing a premier school for a different generation of digital natives. We've got to adapt our thinking and our design approach to that. And then cafeteria. Yes, there will be an auditorium in phase two of this project, but for now, we still need performance space. It would be integrated with the cafeteria space. It could be used for board meetings, board public meetings. There would be a small stage in there. It's not a full dress auditorium space, but it will be there to be used in the school until funding may become available for a full dress auditorium like you have at Hornsby. So we've taken that into account, and the design accommodates that. The site itself, this is where we're looking at it from 10 or 15,000 feet. But the approach is to retain Cooley Field, to give the building curb appeal from the intersection of Long Hill and Ironbound, to retain the annex administration component of that building in phase one. And that kind of defines what we have left to work with on the site. We know we have some water issues. We're going to have to accommodate stormwater. We've got those folks, the civil engineers are looking at that already, how we deal with that and still maintain a lot of green space and the amount of parking that the city requires. So it's all in development. And like I said, we're moving forward with this quickly, but we don't have final plans to show you yet. We're still in the conceptual stage and making decisions about that. The milestones are, the design process will actually run from now through January when we'll have final bid documents done. We have to submit for a variance to the city in September, to the county, and we'll be doing value engineering from September to October to make sure that we are within the budget that's been approved, and then we have to apply for a special use permit. So I think that's the end of it, isn't it? Yeah.
I would just add one thing. In my visit to the school in Arizona, a lot of information in one day from a lot of different people. And the most compelling conversation I had is when the teachers came in and asked them some very pointed questions about, you know, how does this work? And it was really interesting to listen to the teachers' enthusiasm about project-based learning, about how their thinking had changed And one of the teachers said, she said, you know, the interesting thing that we have the opportunity to change direction if we need to. She said, you know, every teacher in the world has written the greatest lesson plan only to find out that it didn't work real well. This opportunity allows us to reorganize and regroup literally on the fly and ensure that the kind of learning that we want to happen takes place. So a lot of information that we got. It was really very interesting for me to talk to people, ask them specific questions. What you're seeing is a concept of a learning neighborhood. There still certainly is a core facility that includes cafeteria and gymnasium and all those things, but and we're getting to those. But I was compelled by the comments from another teacher as well, who said that she was ready to retire 4 years ago. In her words, her quote, she had had it. And this school and the ability to teach this way and the ability to change things and help kids learn differently from day to day and week to week, she has no intention of retiring anytime soon. It's really rejuvenated her. So I talked to the superintendent who created the school, who has since retired. I talked to the superintendent who inherited the design from the school, the building principal. We talked about everything from the learning that occurs when you literally step out of your car. The students have been engaged in designing scientific, I'm not sure what you call those signs, Michael, but there were, the students had written and created science stations where you could learn about the
for
environment.
The building, or pylons with signage on them that inspires. And
yeah, they actually had a little extra money, which I'm sure we won't have, but they were able to create a couple of windmills and have introduced real solar energy into their science curriculum and can monitor it inside the building with their computer. So there's just, it's a very exciting, very inspiring, and that's the word that kept coming back from students, parents that we met, kids that, teachers that we met. It just was an inspirational space, a place that kids really wanted to come to. And I think that that's half the battle, creating a place that students are excited about coming to. So I'm very encouraged, appreciate Michael's help and the help of the architects. Again, this is conceptual, we're not done, but we thought it was important to come and share with you where we are in the process.
Board member questions? Mrs. Manuel?
How long has this building been occupied?
4 years.
4 years.
So they have a taste. It's not just...
Yep.
Any other...
I could share my age here for a minute. This is my 44th year in public K-12 education, so I have seen it all come down the road. This is not an open plan building that we designed for everyone in the 70s and early 80s, and then came back in the mid 80s and put the walls in and straightened out the mechanical system. This is not that thing. This is a different approach. You can see there are learning spaces. They can be similar to what we would call a classroom, but then there are larger gathering spaces. And I think what sealed it for me was the first time I was in the building that we visited a couple of years ago, right after it opened, just kind of walking through the building, some kids in there, and two young women and one young man were coming down the corridor, and I stopped them and I said, how do you guys like the building? And the first young lady said to me, I'll never forget this, I memorized it, I like to fidget. And the movable furniture allows me to fidget and not be a distraction to my classmates. I thought, man, that's some pretty deep understanding. The next young lady said, the natural light in the building makes me feel happy. And the young man said, the movable furniture is comfortable. It makes me feel at home. It makes me want to be here. And I walked away from there thinking, if we can help kids be comfortable in their own skin, if we can do things that make them happy and things that make them want to come to school, I don't know how to do it any better. And particularly in the middle school level, we it's the 6th, 7th, and 8th grades where you either bring them into the educational process or you lose them. And so I think these concepts are speaking loudly to kids that are already in there, and I think you'll be very, very pleased with what we end up with. So thank you.
Ms. Larson?
Thank you. I don't know which of you probably start with you. Because it is, you mentioned a teacher who maybe that wasn't their comfort zone. Mm-hmm. So is that something when you're hiring that you're going to be looking at? And I mean, hopefully it's going to be out here in public a lot, and so people will know what
Absolutely.
The design concept is we're going for. But
and that's a great question. One of the things that I came away with clearly is the need for the professional development before the building opens. They began to prepare for the learning and the curriculum, I think it was 2 years, at least 2 years before the building opened. We certainly will be very clear about the professional development that we need to make sure that the education happens the way it's supposed to happen, because what can't happen is that we design a building for a type of learning and we try to go into that building and do it the way we did it 20 years ago. That won't work. And so we understand the importance of professional development. We've already had that conversation and beginning to sketch out those plans. And I do think that it will, attract teachers. I think we have tremendously creative teachers in this school district, and I think there'll be a lot of them who say, that sounds pretty interesting. I asked about, you know, when they staffed the building, did they appeal to brand new teachers who were right out of college, who were probably, you know, the closest to the digital natives that they were teaching, or did they attract veteran teachers? And their answer was, you know, we attracted everybody. There was really across the board interest from first year teachers who were extremely excited, knew exactly what this was all about. Lots of teachers in the 10 to 15 year range who were looking for something new. And then like the teacher I met who was convinced not to retire to try it out. And she said it was the smartest decision she ever made. So it's a great question, because the professional development and the preparation for learning is as important as designing and building the building.
And I think the lady that was talking about retiring, wasn't she from Fort Eustis?
She was a military wife, and yeah. She knew Williamsburg. She had, I guess they had been stationed at Fort Eustis or somewhere near here. So.
Thank you.
Ms. Cook?
I'm just curious how big the school was, how many students were in the school.
This particular school is about 500 students, so slightly smaller than the school that we're looking at, or phase one of the school that we're looking at.
Was there a selection process for the students in that school? Or was it just a
no.
zoned school?
They replaced a middle school. So
okay.
it was
I know
just...
Arizona has a pretty robust school choice program.
They
have vouchers, I think, so.
Right. This particular school, as I understand it, simply replaced an aging facility. And so
right.
the students...
Right, and it's an Arizona public school.
I mean, no, I understand. I just know yeah. that there's quite a different dynamic out there. You can choose pretty much whatever yeah. you want, and it's paid for by the... by the state, so
I know it's wide open.
I didn't ask that question. The superintendent told me, actually showed me the old school and talked about, she talked a lot about the move from the old building to the new building, so I assumed it was just whoever was in the old building then came to the new one.
Did they repurpose the old building?
They sold it to somebody else. I think it's not repurposed as an educational facility.
Okay. Any other comments from board members? Just a couple of questions. The schedule, you have final bid documents in January of 16?
That's what we're hoping for, yeah.
So the as we develop the conceptual design, go into detailed design, how many looks are we going to get at that?
Well, I think the right answer is as many looks as you want. I think we're planning on at least three.
Okay.
I think that's what we discussed the last time we were here. So
as we said here, this is not floor plans, and this is not what our school is.
No, this was really just an introduction, you know, to let you know that we have at least given this some thought, and we're moving down the road, and we understand that there is a timeline in place.
Right.
I think once we get something more specific, mm-hmm. we need to come back to you at that point, and then. As we discussed.
Now, as we go into the detailed design of what we're going to build, another member who's not here, I would be remiss if I didn't ask about the conceptual design for what the final look is going to be like, and making sure that we have when we do expand it to where we want the school to be, that it fits on the floor plan and the infrastructure's there.
We have, we're very clear that the Phase 2 design needs to be more than, and I remember Mr. Fuentes' words, a gray shaded area. We've had those conversations. We've actually spent some time looking at the site, understanding what that would need to happen. And we do understand the board's desire to make sure that when these plans do come, that Phase 2 plan is thought through, not just a site of future spot.
Right, and that if we have whatever infrastructure we need to support it, whether it's electrical or, you know.
Correct.
Transformer, that stuff is put in there in phase.
We're looking at it as if it's going to be a 900-student school and it's going to be there. And the next time you see the drawings, you'll see the Phase 1 and the Phase 2, how it expands, where it expands, what happens with the parking and the traffic and all that other stuff, as well as the supporting infrastructure. I mean, we're expecting to be built someday. So we've got to take it all into account now.
So are we. It's funny that you mentioned natural light, because as I'm going through this, I wrote that down, natural light. I thought that was very important for the students and, you know, for their, make them comfortable in the school, and that I think that natural light is very important. So I appreciate that aspect to it. It's interesting as we go into this conceptual design and start heading into detailed design, this is not a middle school like, or a school necessarily, that people of my generation, you know, the center aisle with the loaded classrooms and everybody facing it. And if you understand our customer these days, that's not the way they want to learn.
Right.
The old schoolhouse on the prairie, it's just.
21st century success.
Right, and you know, when you mentioned in their connectivity, there's a couple of aspects to that. That's, you know, everybody thinks connectivity, it's wired connectivity, but it's also connectivity with each other and in those, right, and in those spaces and in an area where they're comfortable and where they can learn. And when we start looking at things like flipped classrooms and that kind of thing, this is very conducive to that. So education is not, we don't expect the same educational outcomes that we did 20, 30, 40 years ago. And we shouldn't expect it to be delivered the same way it was delivered 20, 30, 40 years ago.
Well, and I think that's why the professional development is key to this. And that was what Dr. Fruoff shared with us. She started planning that professional development while we were still in the early design phases. She was already downstream in her thinking with, how am I going to get our teachers in here and have them embrace it? So, you know, it's not just designing a building and building it. It's making the building do the vision that it's set to do.
Sure, sure, sure. Any final comments from board members? Ms. Manuel?
I'm just wondering about, is this going to be an LED certified building? Are we going to look at?
LED, yeah.
We're doing it two ways, actually. We do LEED. We've just done our 50th LEED Gold building in Ohio, under Ohio School Facilities Commission funding, which is very tight funding, but we've gotten LEED Gold on 50 buildings now in Ohio. We're doing LEED equivalent, where people don't want to go through the bureaucracy of LEED with the USGBC. There's registration fees, there's sending your utility bills in each year now, and LEED for schools. There's a whole bureaucracy to deal with that. So we're doing a lot of LEED equivalency. And the other thing we're doing is ENERGY STAR certified buildings, which many times it seems the public maybe understands ENERGY STAR because there's a sticker on their refrigerator.
Yeah.
And so we're doing all three, and it's really how far you want to go with it. It will all operate the same. You will have operational cost savings. You'll have the natural light throughout the building. But, you know, we can get into that at some point as to what the cost impacts are with.
Yeah, well, I think when we get into the looking at the plans and all right, that kind of stuff, you begin to look at that. But I just want us to keep that front and center.
Yeah, I think it's important that we have an energy conscious, environmentally conscious,
yep,
design as we go through. Now, whether we want to go through the bureaucracy expense or whatever of LEED is another story, but we want to, another discussion, I guess, is a better way to put that. But I think it's important that we take those aspects into, as we design a modern facility, it needs to be a modern facility with all of the, all those impacts considered as we move forward, so.
Okay.
That's good. Thank you much. Look forward
to... Look forward to coming back and...
Where we go from here.
So. Showing you when it starts to get exciting, when you see the floor plan and the outside.
It's kind of exciting now.
Yeah, we've it's been a long road for us to get to this intersection, so we're kind of excited about getting to this intersection at the moment, so.
Well, we want to get through this intersection and stay on the right route, so.
Absolutely.
Stay in touch.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Thank you, Michael. Appreciate it.
Mr. Chair, just, I'd also like to say that we've worked very closely with city planning and just appreciate the collaboration discussions, and I know that Alan has spent a lot of time talking about bus traffic, where cars will go in, where cars will go out, and the city offices have been just great to deal with so far, and I think when we come back and show you what we're thinking about when it's more developed, it'll be evident that a lot of hands have been in figuring out the very best way to utilize the property, and I think you'll be pleased.
Good. Thank you. That takes us to 10.01, school lunch price increase for school year 2015-2016. Is there a motion to approve the school lunch price increase of 10 cents for the 2015-16 school year?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Second, sir? But I think we need to say the price in your motion.
I don't know the price. It's increasing by 10 cents.
Yeah.
We have no choice.
No, I know.
It's 250 for elementary, 260 for middle, and 275 to 350 for high school.
Okay. The moved in second. Is there any further discussion? Moved and seconded to approve the school lunch price increase of 10 cents to bring the elementary to $2.40, the middle school to $2.50, and the high school to $2.75. Did I get that right? I did not do that right.
To three.
$2.50 for elementary, $2.60 for middle, $2.75 to $3.50 for high school. Better? Ms. Serza?
Ms. Cook?
Aye.
Mrs. Cardasco?
No, I'm not happy with the price increase. I understand that we don't have a choice, but I think that it's not right.
Ms. Emanuel?
Aye.
Ms. Larson?
Aye.
Mr. Nichols?
Aye.
Mr. Kelly?
Aye. 10.02, is there a motion for approval of the fiscal year 2016-2017 budget calendar as presented?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? Ms. Cook?
So per our discussion at the last meeting, I was hoping to see, and maybe I missed it, but inclusion of placeholders for where the governing bodies are meeting, and also the Planning Commission for the CIP portion. I think recognizing that this process doesn't happen in a vacuum and that.
Right. We're not going to have those dates until January, so we could put an asterisk in like we have done for the March meeting, but we don't know those dates at the moment. But it's our intention to put them in when we find out, which may not be until, I think we discussed this morning, January.
We'll know the Planning Commission dates sooner than we will the operating side for the city and county. But as soon as I know those, I will certainly add them and share them with you. But I don't want to put placeholders knowing that they could change.
So the dates that we have in here are for dates that we can control?
Correct.
Mm-hmm. And not the dates that we can't control?
Correct.
Ms. Cook, is that?
Thank you.
Any other questions, comments? It's been moved and seconded for approval of the fiscal year 2017 budget calendar as presented. Ms. Serza?
Mrs. Cardasco?
Aye.
Ms. Emanuel?
Aye.
Ms. Larson?
Aye.
Mr. Nichols?
Aye.
Ms. Cook?
Aye.
Mr. Kelly?
Aye. 10.03, approval of authorization of signatures in absence of the division superintendent. Is there a motion?
So moved.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded to authorize me you say that better, just to make sure that I have the motion that you moved. Moved and seconded to authorize Dr. Heron, Deputy Superintendent, and Mrs. Berta, Chief Financial Officer, to sign State Department of Education documents in the absence of the superintendent.
Correct.
That's what you moved? That's what was seconded?
And I seconded.
Is there any discussion? Ms. Erza?
Ms. Emanuel?
Aye.
Ms. Larson?
Aye.
Mr. Nichols?
Aye.
Ms. Cook?
Aye.
Mrs. Cardasco?
Aye.
Mr. Kelly?
Aye. Is there a motion to adopt policy GBA, prohibition against discrimination and harassment?
Mr. Chair, I move adoption of policy GBA, prohibition against discrimination and harassment, third reading.
Second.
Any discussion?
No.
No discussion. It's been moved and seconded to approve policy, adopt policy GBA, prohibition against discrimination and harassment. Ms. Erza?
Ms. Larson?
Aye.
Mr. Nichols?
Aye.
Ms. Cook?
Aye.
Mrs. Cardasco?
Aye.
Ms. Emanuel?
Aye.
Mr. Kelly?
Aye. Is there a motion to adopt policy GBCC, sexual harassment complaint policy?
Mr. Chair, I move approval of policy GBCC, sexual harassment complaint policy, third reading.
Is there a second?
Second.
Is there any discussion? It's been moved and seconded to adopt policy GBCC, sexual harassment complaint policy, third reading. Ms. Erza?
Mr. Nichols?
Aye.
Ms. Cook?
Aye.
Mrs. Cardasco?
Aye.
Ms. Emanuel?
Aye.
Ms. Larson?
Aye.
Mr. Kelly?
Aye. Is there a motion to approve revisions to policy JBCC, sexual harassment, sexual violence, retitled to sexual harassment complaint policy?
Mr. Chair, I move adoption of policy JBCC, sexual harassment, sexual violence, retitled to sexual harassment complaint policy, third reading.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion?
Just want to point out that we are, of course, in compliance with any legal obligation in terms of notification of authorities when appropriate for those acts that would rise to the level of being able to meet the determination of a charge, I believe.
Right.
And I'm not sure that that's completely clear with what's written, but certainly the authorities would be involved. Okay.
Okay. Any other comments? Been moved and seconded for approval of revisions to policy JBCC, sexual harassment, sexual violence, retitled to sexual harassment complaint policy. Ms. Erza?
Mrs. Cardasco?
Aye.
Ms. Emanuel?
Aye.
Ms. Larson?
Aye.
Mr. Nichols?
Aye.
Ms. Cook?
Aye.
Mr. Kelly?
Aye. Brings us to 10.07. Approve the revision and recoding of policy JP to policy JB, equal educational opportunities, non-discrimination and harassment. Is there a motion?
So moved. 10.07, revision and recoding of policy JP to policy JB, equal educational opportunities, non-discrimination and harassment, third reading.
Is there a second?
Second.
Is there any discussion? Mrs. Cook.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Ms. Zersa placed in your spots, I believe, some language that was included in the first reading of this policy, but then didn't appear in the second reading. But I would like to see it appear in the final policy. And essentially, it's equal education opportunity language that talks about what the school board shall do in terms of providing facilities and a free appropriate education, extracurricular activities. I'm happy to read the entire insertion if you like, but it's in the BSBA sample policy, and as I said, it was in the first reading that we looked at, and I think was inadvertently left out in the second reading, if that's this correct statement.
Okay, so this is language. It wasn't in our policy previous, but it was in the VSBA model policy.
So, yeah.
And that was what you and Mrs. Cardasco looked at in your committees, and then we presented the first one.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Any comments from any other board members?
You could.
They're going to use it, just general consent to include it, rather than go through the motion to amend.
A motion to amend.
Yeah, that's fine with me.
So I would amend.
Any motion?
I'm sorry.
Going to move to amend.
Did you just make a motion?
I have no
Objection to the amendment?
Objection to amending the motion. To include the language.
Mr. Chair, I'd like to amend the motion to include the language, starting with no student on the basis of sex or gender shall be denied equal access to programs, activities, services, et cetera, as presented in this document.
Okay. Mr. Parliamentarian?
You can go either way. You can ask the people who moved the motion and seconded the motion to include it, or you can just ask for general consensus of all, or you can go by doing the more lengthy process of asking to move to amend.
We don't care.
Mrs. Larson has already said that she is okay with this language amended. Mrs. Emanuel says it's okay, so we'll motion as amended.
Okay.
Any further discussion?
So the motion before you now is the one that's amended?
Correct. So it has been moved and seconded. Help me make sure I get this right. To approve the revision and recoding of policy JP to policy JB, equal educational opportunities, non-discrimination, harassment, as amended this evening.
As amended.
As amended. Ms. Serza?
Ms. Cook?
Aye.
Mrs. Cardasco?
No.
Ms. Emanuel?
Aye.
Ms. Larson?
Aye.
Mr. Nichols?
Aye.
Mr. Kelly?
Aye. 10.08, approval of the 2015-2016 Student Code of Conduct. Is there a motion for approval?
Mr. Chairman, I move the approval of the Student Code of Conduct as presented.
Is there a second?
Second.
Is it moved and seconded to approve the 2015-16 Student Code of Conduct? Is there any discussion?
Yes, absolutely.
Mrs. Cardasco?
It was pointed out to me today, and I think it's perhaps an oversight in the fact that we have to be very detailed in what we lay out, that we do not put out a standard of what we do expect. And if it were up to me, I would love to see us actually have a sentence saying what we do expect, something along the lines of treating everybody with respect, exhibiting self-control, following directions. Because when you set a standard of a positive behavior, I think that's far easier than when you begin to go into what is considered negative behavior. So I thought that was a really excellent idea. I always appreciate feedback. And sometimes you can't see the forest for the trees when you're really involved with the detail. So I certainly would wish that that would be something that we could add, because I think it's always better to establish a expectation of something positive rather than to expect something negative.
Positive tone versus the negative tone. Mrs. Cook?
Yeah, I think, Mr. Chair, to echo Mrs. Cardasco, I agree with that. But my experience has been that that does take place, but at the building level, that it's customized to each building. And correct me if I'm wrong. No one's nodding. I mean, my experience is that it's happened at the building level, and it's fairly pervasive. That's a question.
I thought you were leaning forward there to...
That's my understanding. When I visit schools, the schools I've visited, there's specific information about acceptable behaviors and elementary schools, for example, students working on their classroom rules together and the teachers and kids deciding how we're going to treat each other and how we're going to work with each other. I happened to be at Hornsby Middle School last year where there was a sixth grade a meeting in which they were talking about positive behaviors. With all of that said, we would be happy to take a look at a way to do that in the future. We're under a little bit of a time crunch this year in terms of the opening of school, but it's certainly a suggestion that we can look at and try to figure out, are there some general statements that we can make that would be applicable across the division? I think that's something reasonable that we can take a look at.
Okay.
Any other comments?
No, I was just thinking about the timeline and whether they could get it done or not if we were going to hold on this. So I think we need to move forward.
Yeah, I would just like to, I think we all echo Mrs. Cordasco's comments that we'd spend a lot of time thinking about what they can't do, that maybe what they should and what we expect. It is probably certainly a very valid sentiment to have. So I would agree with that. Any further discussion? It's been moved and seconded to...
Oh, my.
For approval of the 2015-2016 Student Code of Conduct as presented. Ms. Serza?
Mrs. Cardasco.
Aye.
Ms. Emanuel.
Aye.
Ms. Larson.
Aye.
Mr. Nichols.
Aye.
Ms. Cook.
Aye.
Mr. Kelly.
Aye.
We're having an attack of the bug.
It's a hornet, I think.
It's all good. Yeah. All right. 11.01, board members' comments. Any board members have any comments this evening?
No.
Ms. Cardasco?
Yeah, I had an opportunity to go down to the, I think we all received an invitation to the Virginia Air and Space Museum to look at a couple of the things that they're doing, and they have a couple of exciting new programs. I know we always have limited resources as far as what we can do school-wide, but I certainly would recommend that families and kids go down and take a look at some of the things that they have, and perhaps it's something that, you know, a teacher might be able to work into their schedule as well.
Ms. Cook?
I actually have a question, if that is appropriate. Is that?
Depends on the question.
It's a question about the Dr. Constantino, your superintendent's report about the open houses. I'm just curious, what do we do as a community to push that information out into the community to know that there, to encourage attendance?
A lot of that is done at the school level. There's generally mailings at each school, but we tweet it out, we're Facebooking. It's on our website calendar right now. We'll continue to promote those as we get closer.
Excellent, thank you.
Yes,
thank you. I just had a couple of comments regarding these policies that we've been working on these past few weeks. We've had a lot of conversations about them, a lot of tweaking, and it was just really important, I think, to me, and I imagine to this board too, that we want to continue to ensure to every degree possible that each of our schools is a safe and comfortable and inspiring place for students to learn, that every student in our school system has the right to an education that is free from danger or disruption. And this board has been consistent in upholding these ideas and has continued tonight with the passing of this policies, because that is the role of this board. It is to work on developing policies which protect the rights of all of our students. And as this world is changing, so must our policies. So I appreciate all the conversation that has gone on, but I don't want to get lost that what is most important is the safety of all students. No one should ever feel threatened or harassed in coming to one of our buildings. I was in Richmond a couple of weeks ago on a top secret BSBA project, which I'm not allowed to talk about, and I didn't know that till after I tweeted from Richmond. You know, they ought to tell you these things when you go in, but I quickly deleted it. But I'm really excited to represent BSBA. Look forward to sharing this with all of you very soon. I will be in Richmond one more time in early October to wrap up that project. I also am serving on the BSBA Task Force on Workforce Readiness. And so we're getting ready to develop we've been working on developing a survey that's going to go out to superintendents. And Ben Kaiser was on our call today. And so I hope that you'll take a minute to fill that out. Ben did express concern because you all get a lot of surveys, but that you would be able to work with the proper people in your administration so that we can get some valuable feedback on that. And we've also enjoying a real partnership with the chamber. And so that's exciting to watch unfold as well. And then the only other comment that I had was, when we decided to adopt starting to do the pledge in our meetings, I was a little concerned because I didn't feel like we had procedures in place, and I continue to have that concern. So I'd really like to discuss a way that we could get some sort of schedule going so that we can make sure. I appreciate the opportunity to, we got the email the other night about some, you know, getting someone to come do it, and I spent yesterday trying to find someone, only to find out that in the meantime people had already been asked and were coming, and that's great, but I want to make sure that everyone sitting up here gets students from their area represented So I'm hoping that we can, it's my understanding that you have someone for September, and I had written you back and asked for October then. So just if there's a way we could nail that down, it would be appreciated.
Okay.
Yeah, that I probably need to issue apologies on that, because that had been set up since we found that we had the James River Award coming in June, but that had not been communicated to the entire board. So that is certainly my responsibility, so I apologize for that. I know that we've also had some representation from Lafayette and from War Hill, but I think it certainly isn't a bad idea to have a schedule. And I also am very glad, in commentary on the policies, that certainly not only our students, but our teachers and our parents and our staff will feel have the freedom to also feel safe, regardless of their political, philosophical, or religious views. So I think it was very good work that we did.
Yeah, and that was also the pledge tonight was my issue. You told me that, and I have.
But it's not just this. I'm not just trying to pick on this month.
I understand.
I just want to get it nailed down so that we can have.
I understand. Any other board member comments? I would like to give Mr. Stipe some shout outs here for the custodians and their hard work over the summer to prepare the school buildings. I know we're getting ready to start amping up here in the next few days for as the teachers start to come back, and shortly thereafter the students, and also the construction projects that we've I trust are going well and moving forward. We have several items on the coming up as far as the school system goes. August 25th, our new teacher orientation kicks off, and August 28th, we have our full convocation. So as we start ramping up, the teachers and the parents and the students all start getting prepared for the school year. There's some best on their preparations and as they get ready for the coming school year. That brings us to 12.01, upcoming meetings. September 1st, 6:30, room 400 at the school board office and at James Blair. We have a work session action items. Then September 15th is our regular meeting at 6:30 here in the boardroom in Building F. Without objection, we're adjourned.